have a living home. I have a living home. I have a future. I have a future. God has a plan for me. God has a plan for me. Oh, this time.
Good morning, everyone, and a very good morning to those online watching us. It's great to have you all here with us. We weren't sure there'd be enough of a congregation for both services, but there is, so I'm very glad that 10 o'clock is reinstated, because otherwise we'd have bust our numbers. So, you know the rules if you're here, but just to recap, please keep a social distance of 2 metres. Please use hand sanitizer. Please wear your masks. Thank you very much for wearing your masks. And please use a track and trace card if you're here in person so we know who is here. Fill it in, that's a little pink slip, and stick it in the box at the back. There's no collection plate passed around. If you want to make an offering, please stick it in the bin at the back and it will be brought forward at hymn number 5. Now, if you're here, you've got your service sheets. If you're online, just follow the links from the newsletter to the service order for today. You'll find the service order there ready to go, and you'll find a kids' activity sheet as well that you can join in on. So no expense spared here, you know. If you're here, sadly you can't sing. But if you are at home, you can sing as loudly as you like and annoy the neighbours, okay? So I'm going to hand over to Richard in a second, who's leading our service today. But we have a very simple opening sentence from the Bible. It says, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." Amen to that. Richard, all yours.
Thank you, Dave. And let me echo that warm welcome both to everyone who's gathered here today in this building and those who are tuned in on the live stream. And while our live streamers are finding that order of service on the St John's website, let me say what a joy it is that we are able gradually to be safely meeting in a larger number of services, that we're still able to keep safe together in this one place at 12 o'clock, but that we were able to have fellowship at 10 as well. And we pray for the continued rollout of vaccines and scientific and safe and hygienic methods that will allow us to be able to come together as one people and as one fellowship. And we pray that we are able to keep safe and sensible as we do this. And in fact, the three songs that we're singing in this time of prayer and praise are very much about us bringing ourselves to the security of God as individuals and as a fellowship. We sing that we want to be drawn closer, the Father of life drawing us closer to Him. We sing of wanting to be surrounded by God's protection and God's love. And in our first song, this is a song that we sang for the first time as the recessional last Sunday after the service. But we've now put it into this prayer and praise set with the hope that other people can join in. Reminds us that of all the darkness of the last year and a bit, of all the dark times in any of our lives, when everything else is shaken, God is still God. God is still faithful. God still loves and protects and remains. So again, as Dave said, if you're here in church with us today, please do mumble and hum along behind masks. If you're at home, and hopefully you found that order of service, please do sing along with us in all three of these songs, starting with, when all foundations have been shaken, you are still God.
Foundations have been shaken, and when I'm standing in the dark, and all I feel is my heart breaking, you still reign and you're still God. And when it feels all hope has faded, the heavy questions hit so hard, and though my soul may feel forsaken, you still reign and you're still God. Though I can't see what's before me, I know that I can trust your heart, and this one truth will be my story. You still reign and you're still God. I will declare that you are with me, though voices whisper that you're not. You'll never leave me nor forsake me, 'cause you still reign and you are God. Though I can't see what's before me, I know that I can trust your heart, and this one truth will be my story, that you still reign and you are God. Though I can't see what's before me, I know that I can trust your heart, and this one truth will be my story, that you still reign and you are the victory of your cross, and fix my eyes upon you, Jesus, 'cause you still reign and you are God. And you are good and you are faithful, and you have been right from the start. You still reign and you're still God. Though I can't see what's before me, I know that I can trust your heart,
truth will be my story. You still reign and you are God. Yes, this one truth will be my story. You still reign and you're still God.
Oh, Holy Spirit.
spirit, long my comfort. Strength the meek, hold my head up high, and I'll stand upon your truth, bringing glory unto you, and let the peace of God let it rain. Oh, Holy Spirit, saturate my soul, and let the life of God fill me now. Let your healing power bring life and make me whole, and let the peace of God let it rain. Saturate my soul, and let the life of God fill me now. Let your healing power bring life and make me whole, and let the peace of God let it rain.
Father, let your peace reign, we pray. Let it reign in our country and in our world. Let it reign in our midst here. Lord, be our foundation, our faithful one, our rock, as we face the state of our world, the state of our lives at the moment. Lord, let us trust always in you, we pray. Amen. Amen. If you're here in person, you'll find our prayers on the yellow sheets. Let's join together, please, in the prayer of preparation. We pray. Heavenly Father, you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to make us ready to meet with you. Send your Holy Spirit on us now, we pray, that we may hear your word, share in your communion, receive your grace, and be renewed in your love. Amen. The Bible says the sacrifice of God is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart God will not despise. Let us come to the Lord who is full of compassion. Acknowledge our transgression and confess our sins together. So with the Lent confession, we join in together, please. God, our Father, we are truly sorry and confess our sins. Forgive us for our thoughtless behavior, for ignoring your will and your ways, and for letting ourselves be drawn away from you. Save us from the temptations of the world about us, and help us to serve you in newness of life. To the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Pardon us and set us free from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal. Amen. A special prayer for this week, the second Sunday of Lent. Almighty God, you show to those who are in error the light of your truth, that they may return to the way of righteousness. Grant to all those who are admitted into the fellowship of the church, that we may reject those things which contradict our belief, and follow all that uphold the faith, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our theme today is following our Lent theme of Take Up Your Cross. And specifically, Robert's going to be talking about God's heartbeat, compassion for the poor. So, before he speaks, Iris is going to read to us from the book of Deuteronomy.
So our reading is from Deuteronomy chapter 24, beginning at verse 17. Do not deprive the foreigner or the fatherless of justice, or take the cloak of a widow as a pledge. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt, and the Lord your God redeemed you from there. That is why I command you to do this. When you are harvesting in your field and you overlook a sheaf, do not go back to get it. Leave it for the foreigner, the fatherless, and the widow, so that the Lord your God may bless you in all the work of your hands. When you beat the olives from your trees, do not go over the branches a second time. Leave what remains for the foreigner, the fatherless, and the widow. When you harvest the grapes in your vineyard, do not go over the vines again. Leave what remains for the foreigner, the fatherless, and the widow. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our gospel reading is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 25, reading from verse 31 to 46. Hear the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people, one from another, as the shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was ill, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see the hungry and feed you, or the thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you, a stranger, and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and go to visit you? The king will reply, Truly I tell you, whatever you did for the least, for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. Then he will say to those on the left, Depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was ill and in prison, and you did not look after me. They also will answer, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or needing clothes, or ill or in prison, and did not help you? He will reply, Truly, I tell you, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me. Then they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. The sermon topic is take up your cross. And, well, the rest of that verse is take up your cross and follow me. So I got my cross. And I thought, well, this is perhaps the best way to illustrate the sermon. So Dave has written, preach a sermon and take up your cross. I've taken up my cross, and I'm going to follow, well, not Dave, but I'll follow Christ. Is that correct, Dave?
That's right, yes, yes.
I should take up my cross.
Maybe not, truly. Don't want to carry that all day tomorrow,
do you? Oh, Lord, I may have to change my sermon now.
Never mind.
But the story is, well, the verse says, take up your cross and follow me. There is an image up there on the window at the back. Take up your cross and follow me. The message of this cross, of this these two pieces of wood, is death. The message is ultimate death when you go to Golgotha. But in fact, the message of the cross that Jesus carried was a message of love. And God is saying to you through this cross, I love you so much. My own son is willing to go to the cross for you. Whoever you are, whatever you look like, wherever you come from, whatever tribe or nation or language you speak, look, I made you. I created you in my image, and I die for you. The message of this cross is a message of love, ultimate pure love for each and every single one of us. So it is actually very apt for us to think of this as the message of taking up your cross and following Christ. But it's a message that we take on ourselves as followers of Christ. We take up our cross, following Christ and doing exactly what he did in the world. Now, there are so many illustrations of how that works out, but I think the best illustration is where Jesus, using an Old Testament passage, where he says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love God with every part of your being. Love him with all your strength. Love him with every part of your being. And God is not impressed by our religion. Please, God is not impressed. He knows you more than you know yourself. But he's just asking you, love God completely. And then Jesus pushes it further and he says, love your neighbor as you love yourself. Now, do you love yourselves? Do we love those who are watching online? Do we love ourselves?
Yeah.
Yes, only one person answered there. Okay. Only one person in this whole room loves himself. That's my brother Nick here. Okay. Do we love ourselves?
Yes.
Yes, of course we do. In different ways. You might say, oh no, I don't love myself. I love people more. Are you sure? When you get up in the morning, you adorn yourself, put all that perfume and all that. I think there's a little bit of love for yourself there. All right? But he's really saying, the challenge is, he's saying, love your neighbor as you love yourself. Love the other person as you love yourself. What? Love Donald Trump as I love myself? A bit difficult for me, personally. But I think he's actually pushing the boundary even more than that. He is saying to us, go beyond that which you are familiar with, your comfort zone. Love your neighbor as much as you love yourself. Would you eat food at home? Would you buy good food and all the other things? Would you do good things for yourself? Yes, I think we would. And in the same way, do that for others. Now, the second passage that we read, the gospel passage, which speaks about what did I do? Lord, what did I do? How come you're blessing me? And says, the thing you did for the least of my brothers and sisters, the thing that you didn't even think about, you offered water, a glass of water. Or maybe if you have a car and somebody's walking, you gave them a lift, possibly. Or maybe you realized you found out that somebody at home, somebody, your neighbor, had nothing to eat, and you offered them something. Whatever it is, maybe there is somebody in hospital you went to visit, somebody in prison, and you went to, you know, talk to them. Whatever it is that we do, we love our neighbor as we love ourselves. Now, there are so many examples of people who have done this, but there's one particular, it's not a philosophy, it's actually a teaching. It's a Catholic teaching, Roman Catholic teaching, called Catholic social teaching. Let me just read a little bit of that for you. Now, the Catholic social teaching basically gives us the opportunity. Let me just read this. Catholic social teaching is based on the belief that God has a plan for creation a plan to build his kingdom of peace, love, and justice. God has a plan. He has a plan for everything, for all his creation. And that means you and me. He has a plan for all of us. It also says, it holds that God has a special place in this story, his story, for each of us, whoever we may be. Anybody who might think, oh, God doesn't love me, that is not true. That is from the devil. God absolutely loves you, and he has a plan for you. He has a plan for each and every single one of us. In his story, he has a plan for each one of us in his story. Our part in this plan isn't just limited to things spiritual or things we might do on Sundays. Coming here on a Sunday, that's not just that part of the plan. Yes, we come here because we come to have fellowship. And even those who are watching online, the reason you would watch online is because you want to be a part of that fellowship. But that's not it. That's not the whole picture. I would say that the picture is more than that. The picture is our involvement in the world around us. The things, our part in this story is a kind of vocation for the common good, a call to treat everyone as your brothers and sisters, and is something that we all share. It is a responsibility. It is a part of what we need to do. It is our job. Not for those wearing collars, primarily, but it's for everybody. If you bear the name of Jesus, Christian, if you bear that name, it is for you as well. You have a part in that story. A quote from Pope Francis: whenever our interior life becomes caught up in its own interests and concerns, there is no longer room for others, no place for the poor, which is what we are looking at. God's voice is no longer heard. The quiet joy of his love is no longer felt, and the desire to do good fades. If we are so self-absorbed and we forget what others are like, then God's voice is no longer heard from within us. That we are familiar with, we've probably spoken about this several times here, the five marks of mission. One of the marks of mission says, to respond to human need by loving service. Our response to the needs of others by our loving service. How we help other people, how we look at other people, and how we stand along other people. I went for a funeral service yesterday, and it was a very, very difficult service because everybody was in tears. Everybody, I must say, the whole room was just, everybody burst into tears because they were really heartbroken. But what I found myself doing was standing alongside those who were in tears, because I had been there before. I've been in that situation before. And because I had been there and I tasted a little bit of it, I knew what I needed to do, to stand alongside those who were crying their hearts out, and will probably still continue crying. That was my job, to stand alongside. And maybe that's what we ought to do too. That's part of our job, to respond to human need by our loving service. I want to give you a very interesting quote by a late bishop, David Shepherd. He was Bishop of Liverpool. And he said something very interesting. He said, if we have no gospel for the city, we have no gospel. If there is no good news for the city, if there is no good news for the people who live outside in the fringe, if we have no good news for the common person, then we have no gospel. What are we doing? We're just a Sunday club who come here to meet and look at each other, get upset with each other's clothing, and go home. If we do not have a gospel for those who are marginalized, those who are suffering, those who are dispossessed, those who are suffering big problems, then we really have no gospel. We have no good news. The gospel of the kingdom is having both a personal and a prophetic dimension. There is a personal part of that gospel. You believe, I believe in Jesus, personally. But there is a prophetic in that. We speak into our world, we speak into the problems of our world. We engage with those problems. We are part of those issues. That's where we belong. That's where we are supposed to be. Not outside. Not in the ivory tower of cathedrals and so on. Please, I love cathedrals. I'm not saying that cathedrals are bad. But not huddled away from the world, but in the world, solving, helping to solve problems of the world. I love the ministry of the late Mother Teresa. She went to Calcutta. She went to be a part of the poor in Calcutta. She went into the problem to make the problem better, to resolve some of those issues. We may not be called to go to Calcutta. That may not be our calling. But wherever we may be, God calls us to be prophetic in our situation, in our circumstances. Jesus speaks of the poor you will always have with you, but you will not always have me. Oh yes, the poor will always be in this world. And as long as they are in this world, we are responsible for their plight too. We are responsible for prayer, for helping resolve some of the issues that are there. The gospel reading we had from Matthew takes this a step a little higher. And there is the element here of, well, do I really have to do anything? Is it of any consequence? I can be a Christian and sort of just bide my time until Jesus comes back. Mm-hmm. Or I can be a Christian and when I die, that's it, I go to heaven. Well, there is an eternal consequence to our actions. Someone once said, what we do now in this life will echo into eternity. We have a responsibility to the people around us, and that it has an eternal consequence. And in the story in the Gospel of Matthew, he says, there are those who have done the things that Jesus wanted them to do, to help people, to stand with people. But then, of course, there are those who did not, and who say, well, I didn't see you. I didn't see you physically. I didn't see you were thirsty. I didn't see you were hungry. I didn't see you in need. Maybe we chose not to see. Maybe we chose not to be a part of that. Maybe the simple things of contributing to a food bank were too much for us. Maybe just knocking the door of your neighbor, just finding out how they are, was a bit too much for you. I told this story earlier. It's a bit harrowing, but let me repeat it. I read something yesterday. A young lady was at home, she lived alone. It seems as though she didn't really have many friends. She had a job, she'd go to work, come back home, that was it. And so she was watching television. And unfortunately on this particular day, she had a heart attack. And she died. But she lived alone. And the door was locked. And the TV was on. So all through that day, the TV played, she was dead. Nobody came to knock on the door. Nobody came to find out how she was. The next day, the TV was still on. The neighbors might have heard it, but they didn't bother to come check. The next week, mind you, the TV was still on. Her rent was being paid because she had set it up on direct debit. Nobody came to check up. She was dead. The next month, brothers and sisters, nobody came to check up on this girl. Several months later, nobody checked up. The thing was, there was rubbish outside her flat, and it stunk. So nobody could smell her body rotting in the house. And she stayed there. The TV was still on. Her rent was still being paid. And then it was a year later that the landlord then realized, well,
her account was dried up, because she was not working anymore. Her account was dried up. And the landlord decided to find out, you know, how come she's not paying her rent. But he let it be. He sent a letter. He sent a couple of letters. And these all fell on the heap in the house, on the front door. And a couple of months after, in the second year, he decided that he was going to get rid of the girl. He was going to go to the house, the flat, and kick her out of the flat. And it was then that they found out that this girl had died 2 years before. This was a true story. Brothers and sisters, friends, this may be slightly far-fetched for you, but the point that is being made is this. What is our response? What is our response? What is our response of love to those around us? And particularly to those who are poor, those who have nothing, those who are dispossessed for whatever reason, circumstances, especially now in the pandemic. People have lost jobs, people have lost businesses, or businesses are falling apart. What is our response? Our response should be Jesus' response, God's response. Love. I love you. Love the world. And let us go into the world. Let this be our vocation. Let this be us being the heartbeat of God, the compassion of God in the world in which we live. And sometimes it starts from a very small place, little things that we may do. Some of us here who have family in other countries, supporting those at home. I know it can be difficult, but even that, just a little bit. Little things we do go a long way in many respects. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Robert, for that very powerful word. Let's pray. Father, we pray for the poor and the dispossessed in our world. We pray for those who are victims of greed, those who are victims of war, those who've fallen through the cracks. We pray for those in our community who are reliant on food banks. Lord, we thank you for the many responses to poverty. We pray that there may be many more. And we pray today particularly for the Stratford Food Bank and for all who work there. We pray for those who are working to reach out to the homeless. We pray for the work of StreetLink and Newham Council's homeless outreach team. We pray, Lord, for those who are working for the alleviation of poverty worldwide. And we remember especially Tear Fund and the work that they do in so many different places amongst people of all nations, all cultures, all faiths. Lord, we bring to you the poor in our world. We pray that you will help us and guide us to reach out to them. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah.
We pray, Lord, for the difficult places of our world. We pray for Myanmar at this time and pray for democracy and justice there. We pray for Leah Sheribu, now a captive for 3 years. And we pray for the 300 Nigerian girls kidnapped this week. Lord, we pray for their freedom. And we pray for justice and equal access to medical treatment, and particularly to vaccines, for those in the poorer places in our world. Lord, in your mercy. We pray, Lord, for those who are sick. We pray for Anjum, for Minta, for Margaret, for Mona, for Tom, for Bernadette, recently in hospital, for Grace, for Samuel, for Brenda, for Denise, and for her very elderly mother, for Marcia, for Christy, and we pray for all who are suffering from coronavirus, and for all who care for them. And we give you thanks, Lord, for our health service, and particularly for those volunteers who are vaccinating thousands of people every day. Lord, heal the sick, we pray, and give strength to those who care for them. Lord, in your mercy. And sadly, we give thanks for the life of many departed people today. We give thanks for the life of Nora, Lydia's sister, who died yesterday in Ghana. We give thanks for the life of Harry, Shiva's brother-in-law, and Liz, Shiva's sister. And we pray for Shiva and for her family. We give thanks for the life of Catherine, Jackie's mum. And we pray for Jackie in her sorrow. We give thanks for the life of Richard Aguma and pray for his wife Esther and the family and for their journey as they take Richard back to Uganda this week. And we give thanks for the life of Lucille. Pray for her family and for her funeral as her family say farewell to her tomorrow. Father, we're reminded that there are so many bereaved people as a result of COVID. We commit them to you and pray for your comfort for them. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray that you'll lead us and guide us in your service. We pray that your church may be ready to serve you as you call us and lead us and send us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We'll now join in the peace. So since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us access to his grace. So brothers and sisters, may the peace of the Lord be with you and also with you. Let us share with one another a sign of peace. And we say, peace with you, be with you, those watching from home. May the peace of the Lord be with you. God bless you. We'll now sing our next song, which is the Offertory Hymn, hymn number 5, Beauty for Brokenness. And if you wish to make an offering for those who are here, we have a bucket at the back near where the welcomers are, where you're welcome to place your offering. So song number 5, Beauty for Brokenness.
Christ for the bitterness, his cross for the
Christ for the ravaged earth, oceans and streams, plundered, poisoned, our future, our dreams. Lord, end our madness, carelessness, greed. Make us content with the things that we need. God of the poor, friend of the weak, give us compassion, we pray. Melt our cold hearts, let tears fall like rain. Come change our love from a spark to a flame. Lighten our darkness, breathe on this flame, until your justice burns brightly again. Until the nations learn of your ways, seek your salvation and bring you their praise. God of the poor, friend of the weak, bring us compassion, we pray. Melt our cold hearts, let tears fall like rain. Come change our love from a spark to a flame.
Lord, we thank you for these gifts. We thank you for all who have given here today and those who have given in other ways. We thank you, Lord, for your provision. We give back to you in praise and in honor. May you use these gifts for the glory of your kingdom, to lift up your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'll now join in the Eucharistic prayer on your yellow sheets, the Holy Communion prayer on your yellow sheets. So, brothers and sisters, the Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all a perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and the blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. And as our Savior taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. We invite any communicant member of any Christian churches to come receive communion. If you are coming forward to receive communion, please do come down the middle aisle in one queue, not two queues, please, one queue, and socially distancing yourselves. When you get to the front, Iris and I will be here to offer you the bread. Please extend one hand forward and we'll put the bread in your hand. Please go back to your seats using the side aisle, if you may. I will receive the wine on behalf of the congregation. So brothers and sisters, draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts, by faith, with thanksgiving.
No wisdom, but I
death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom.
Have no power of ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The prayer after communion on your yellow sheets. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen.
I've got some notices and some birthdays and a word from Stephen, who's back with us for the first time this year, having been quite seriously ill. So welcome back, Stephen. He's going to say a few words in a moment. Next service today is at 18:30, and that's a repeat of this service. I'm glad we've split the services again. I don't know how many we've got here, but I think we would have been well past our limit had we not had a 10 o'clock service. So welcome to you all. The 18:30 service tonight, we've got the Zoom meeting as well. This is at 6:55, and this is for the YPF group. Christchurch 3 Mills are meeting on Zoom. If you want to know more, email Dan and he'd love to give you the Zoom access code. But we're not allowed to print Zoom access codes for Christchurch on this sheet. Mea culpa, mea culpa, mea culpa. If you logged on to the 6 p.m. prayer last night, you'd have noticed there wasn't anything there. That's because the dozy old vicar forgot it was 6 o'clock and the dozy old vicar's wife forgot to bring her camera. Okay? So, apologies for this. We managed right through February. Indeed, we were so enthusiastic that one night we managed 2 live broadcasts. I did one and Robert did one as well. Now, 6 p.m. prayer has proved to be, it's had quite a following. So for the rest of Lent, at least, we're going to have a slightly different evening prayer at 6 p.m. on Monday. And it'll be on Facebook Live again. There'll be a brief service liturgy on the website. Just follow the links from the online newsletter. And you can see the readings for the week and the special prayer for the week are printed on the newsletter here. They're also on the online newsletter. And if you click on the reading on the online newsletter, you get taken straight to the Bible passage, such as the wonder of technology and the amazing skill of our techie guy, Gary. Okay, So either log on at 6 p.m. from Facebook Live or pray where you are if you wish. But evening prayer will be there, we hope. And thanks to other members of the team who are joining in with us as well. Tomorrow we've got funeral of Lucy Johansson here at 11. Please pray for the funeral and for her family. Tuesday top-up on Facebook Live is 7 to 7.45 on Tuesday. And we'll be looking at this beginning of John chapter 15, not just the gardeners. Okay, and you can post questions and prayer requests, either email them to the church office, or you can post them as comments on the actual Facebook live stream. And Thursday is Holy Communion at 12:40. That's the repeat of this service without music. Friday is the Lent study course. Ayo's leading this from 9 p.m. till 10 p.m. This is a study course for late night people. You can see we've got the Zoom code here on the printed newsletter. To avoid trolls, we can't put it on the online newsletter, okay? Now, if you find you can't find things on the online newsletter, then email me at the church office and I'll quite happily send links to you. You should all be getting an email from me once a week on average from the church office. If you don't get it, firstly, check your spam box, okay? Because Iris's emails from me always go into spam. Yeah, I don't know why, your email doesn't like me, yes. But check your spam box, or if you think you're not getting emails, you should give me your email, preferably in writing, or even send me an email and say, add me to your list, please, okay? What else? Barking Year Evocations Day, this is also on Zoom on the 6th of March. The password's here again, and it's not on the online newsletter, so you'll have to remember it from... Take this sheet home with you guys. And we're having our audit team in on March. All the finance team are coming to do the audit for last year's accounts. So please pray for us. It's a long, hard day, usually. Next Sunday, it's Holy Communion at 10, 12 and 6:30. It's YPF Zoom, as usual. If you want to talk to me about giving, if you want details of bank giving, or you want offering envelopes, chat to one of us at the door, okay, and give us a note in writing. Stephen, come and talk to us. Come and use this microphone here, Stephen. It's really great to welcome Stephen back to us. Hang on, come round. You need to stand up close to that mic.
God is good.
Amen.
All the time. Yes. The last time you saw me here was November last year. Third Sunday, to be precise. I fell down where I was, I was on site, and from there I didn't come back until they discharged me because of COVID. In order not to catch COVID again, they discharged me 2 weeks earlier. But I was taken to mortuary twice, and I was rejected. So it was not a joke. And I've been here since 1980. I've not slept 2 nights, more than up to a week in the hospital. And this time around, I spent over a month in the hospital. So, in Nigeria, they call me a Yoruba. They will call that somebody who has visited heaven and came back. I didn't know what heaven looked like, because I didn't want to go. I started begging God, and God was faithful. Thank you very much. Those who were able to get across to me, those who didn't know what happened, I had to tell them. I did not commit any crime. I just fell down on site, and that was it. And that's how it went. My daughter was trying to tell me, and she started crying. So I stopped her. They wanted to show me the picture. I didn't want to see it, because the first picture I saw was not welcoming at all. So I didn't want to see it. I'm grateful to those who prayed for us and those who supported my wife. I didn't know 90% of what happened to me. I knew I fell down. I knew the ambulance carried me. And I knew a week to my discharge that I was alive. Thank you. I knew they took me to mortuary. I knew I was taken back to the world. I knew I was staggering. There was nothing. February 16 was my birthday last year. That was the last birthday before the COVID started. But I couldn't celebrate this year. I was on my bed, drowned. Thank you, and God bless you. I haven't got enough time to say it all, but having said that, I'm very grateful for your prayer and for your understanding. Thank God and be good. Thank you.
Thanks, Stephen, for sharing that with us. Thank you. And it is great to have Stephen back. I've got some birthdays now. A birthday card for Kayla Cooper, who is 9 on Wednesday. Kayla, happy birthday. I hope you're watching. Yeah, round of applause, yeah. A birthday card for Brianna Buckridan, who is 13 on Wednesday. I know you're watching, Brianna. Happy birthday. You see, you've got a fan club in the back there, yes. A birthday card for Alex Ikpefu, who is 14 on Monday. Happy birthday, Alex. And a birthday card for Mercy Nagaraja, who is 15 on Saturday. Happy birthday, Mercy. Right, I've got a few more birthday cards as well. Jonathan Facey is 22 on Wednesday. Happy birthday, Jonathan, if you're watching. Round of applause. Olajide Adegboye's birthday is Friday. Mary Lynn Williams' birthday is Friday, and she's here. Give her a round of applause. Whoa. Happy birthday, Mary Lynn. Peter Kayanja's birthday on Thursday. Edna Alotte's birthday on Saturday. Millie Ferguson's birthday on Monday, and she was here at the 10 o'clock service, and we didn't welcome her, so better phone her, hadn't I? Happy birthday to Millie. Happy birthday, Millie. And Henrietta Olujovi's birthday today. Happy birthday, Henrietta. Hope you're watching. That's it on the birthdays. If you're having a birthday this week, then may God bless you. It's back to Robert now.
We're now going to sing our last song, song number 8, Lord, the light of your love is shining, song number 8.
Yeah.
So brothers and sisters, let's go out and know that God has loved us, and we love the world because he loved us. Let us go out and love the poor because God loves the poor. Let us go out and be a light in the world in which we live to help this world find Jesus. Let us go out and be the peace of our world. And so may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always. Amen. Let us go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.
As we gaze on your kingly brightness, so our faces display your likeness, ever changing from glory to glory. Mirrored here, may our lives tell your story. Oh,